What if I told you that our planet, our entire world, is less than a single grain of sand on a cosmic beach so vast it defies imagination? Scientists have an estimate for the number of planets in the universe, a number so colossal it forces us to question everything we know about our place in the cosmos. Over the next few minutes, we're going on a journey from our tiny planetary home to the edge of everything. By the end, we'll arrive at a final tally so enormous, it begs one of the most profound questions of all. In this impossibly vast ocean of worlds, how could we possibly be alone? Let's start with what we know. The ground under our feet is part of a planet, Earth, the third of eight planets orbiting our star, the Sun. For most of history, Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn were just wandering lights in the night sky, treated like mystical, godlike beings. It took pioneers like Copernicus and Galileo, with their revolutionary ideas and early telescopes, to reframe them as worlds, just like ours, circling the Sun. Uranus and Neptune came later, spotted only after we built much more powerful telescopes, and for a while, that was that. Eight planets. It's the number we all learn in school. These worlds meet three key rules set by the International Astronomical Union in 2006. They orbit the Sun. They're massive enough for gravity to have squished them into a nearly round shape, and they have cleared their orbital neighborhood of other big objects. That last rule is famously what got Pluto kicked out of the club. For 76 years, Pluto was our ninth planet. But as our telescopes peered deeper into the outer solar system, into an icy realm called the Kuiper Belt, we realized it wasn't alone. Not even close. We found other objects like Eris, Haumea, and Makemake, some similar in size or even more massive than Pluto. It became clear Pluto wasn't the king of its orbit, but more like the biggest kid in a huge, crowded playground of icy bodies. So the definition had to change, and our solar system officially shrank to eight planets. But the story in our own backyard might not be finished. Strange wobbles in the orbits of the most distant objects in the Kuiper Belt have led some astronomers to hunt for a true ninth planet. They call it Planet Nine. This wouldn't be a dwarf planet, but a massive world, maybe 5 to 10 times the mass of Earth, lurking in the darkness far beyond Neptune. The catch? No one has actually it. Its existence is just a theory, based on the gravitational tugs it seems to be exerting on the frozen worlds at the edge of our solar system. The search is on, with powerful telescopes scanning the skies for a faint, slow-moving dot of light. So even here, in the most well-studied planetary system in the universe, there are still mysteries. We have eight confirmed planets, a bunch of fascinating dwarf planets, and the tantalizing ghost of a hidden giant. But this is just our home, a single star system among hundreds of billions. To really start counting, we need to take our first great leap outwards. For thousands of years, the stars were just pinpricks of light. People wondered if they were like our sun, and if they had their own planets. It was a question for philosophy and science fiction. But in the last 30 years, everything changed. We now have the answer. Yes, the stars are other suns, and they are overwhelmingly orbited by planets. We call them exoplanets, planets outside our solar system. The first was confirmed in 1992, orbiting something truly wild, the hyperdense spinning corpse of a dead star called a pulsar. Then, in 1995, came the big one, 51 Pegasi b, the first exoplanet found orbiting a normal sun-like star. That discovery opened the floodgates. Missions like NASA's Kepler Space Telescope and TESS were launched specifically to hunt for these worlds. They stare at hundreds of thousands of stars, just waiting for that telltale dip in brightness that signals a planet passing in front of its star. It's called the transit method, and it has been wildly successful. As of late 2025, NASA has confirmed the existence of over 6,000 exoplanets, with thousands more candidates waiting in the wings. 6,000 new worlds on our cosmic map. And the pace is picking up. It took until 2022 to hit 5,000, but only a few more years to find the next 1,000. What's even more mind-blowing is how weird these worlds are. We've found hot Jupiters, gas giants orbiting so close to their stars their atmospheres are being boiled away. We've seen super-Earths, rocky worlds bigger than our own. We've discovered planets where it might rain glass sideways, and others with the density of styrofoam. The universe, it turns out, is far more creative at building planets than we ever gave it credit for. So, 6,000 confirmed planets is a great start. But that's just what we've been able to spot from our tiny corner of the galaxy. To get a real estimate, scientists have to extrapolate. Based on data from missions like Kepler, they can make a statistical guess. They look at the fraction of stars where they found planets, and then account for all the ones they probably missed, planets that are too small, too far out, or don't pass in front of their star from our point of view. When they do this, the number is staggering. The current scientific consensus is that, on average, there is at least one planet for every star in our galaxy. Some estimates even suggest the average is higher. Let that sink in. Look up at the night sky. Nearly every single star you see likely has its own family of worlds. So, let's do the math. How many stars are in our galaxy, the Milky Way? It's tough to get an exact count, but estimates range from 100 billion to 400 billion. Let's take a solid, middle-of-the-road estimate of 200 billion stars. If there's at least one planet per star, that means there are, at a bare minimum, 200 billion planets in the Milky Way galaxy alone. 200 billion. If you were to count one planet every single second, it would take you over 6,300 years to count to 200 billion. It's a number on a truly galactic scale. But the Milky Way is just our home island. Our next step is to zoom out further and cross the vast ocean to other galaxies. Before we leave our galaxy, there's a detour we have to take, because among those 200 billion planets, the question that really burns is, how many could be like Earth? How many could have the right conditions for life? This is the search for habitable planets. Astronomers have a concept called the habitable zone, or the Goldilocks zone. It's the sweet spot around a star where the temperature is just right, not too hot, not too cold, for liquid water to exist on a planet's surface. And as far as we know, liquid water is a key ingredient for life. Finding a planet in the Goldilocks zone is step one. Step two is making sure it's rocky, like Earth, and not a gas giant like Jupiter. For years, we could only guess how common these worlds might be. But thanks to Kepler, we now have a statistical answer. One analysis suggests there could be as many as 300 million potentially habitable worlds in the Milky Way. Another study, including planets around the more common but cooler red dwarf stars, pushes that number as high as 40 billion. Let's just pause on that. Not 40 billion planets, but 40 billion planets, right here in our home galaxy. Some could be as close as 20 to 30 light years away, practically our next door neighbors in cosmic terms. This is where the James Webb Space Telescope comes in. It's a game changer. It isn't just counting planets, it's studying their atmospheres. By capturing starlight that passes through a planet's air, Webb can look for the chemical fingerprints of gases like water vapor, methane, and carbon dioxide. These are potential biosignatures, gases that could hint at life. We haven't found definitive proof yet, but for the first time in history, we actually have the tools to look. So, as we prepare to leave the Milky Way, keep this in mind. Our galaxy isn't just filled with 200 billion planets. It's potentially filled with hundreds of millions, maybe billions of worlds where life could get a foothold. We've set our baseline. Our Milky Way galaxy likely hosts at least 200 billion planets. Now it's time to zoom out again. The Milky Way, as vast as it is, doesn't float alone in the dark. It's part of a small cluster of over 50 galaxies, all gravitationally tied together, called the Local Group. Think of it as our local cosmic city. The undisputed giants of this city are our Milky Way and the Andromeda Galaxy. Andromeda is our closest major galactic neighbor, about 2.5 million light years away. It's even bigger than our galaxy, containing perhaps a trillion stars. And if the one planet per star rule holds true, and there's no reason to think it doesn't, then Andromeda is home to a cool 1 trillion planets. The third largest member is the Triangulum Galaxy, with about 40 billion stars and therefore around 40 billion planets. Then you have dozens of smaller dwarf galaxies orbiting the big ones, each with their own billions of stars and planets. So let's just do some quick back-of-the-napkin math. You have 1 trillion planets in Andromeda, 200 billion in the Milky Way, 40 billion in Triangulum, plus all the planets in the smaller galaxies. Suddenly, you're talking about trillions of planets just in our little cosmic neighborhood. We've just taken one small step outside our own galaxy, and the number of worlds has already become almost meaningless. We're now in the realm of trillions, but this cosmic city is just one suburb in a much, much larger metropolitan area. It's time to zoom out again. Our sense of scale is about to break. We went from 8 planets to 200 billion in our galaxy to trillions in our local group. Each step is a huge leap in perspective. Here comes another one. Our local group isn't adrift in an empty void. It's part of an even grander structure. We are on the outskirts of a colossal collection of galaxies known as the Virgo Supercluster. If the local group is our cosmic city, the Virgo Supercluster is our home state. It spans over 110 million light years across and contains at least 100 different galaxy groups and clusters. At its heart lies the massive Virgo Cluster, a dense swarm of over 1,000 galaxies. Our entire local group is actually being pulled toward the center of this supercluster by the immense force of its gravity, a journey we're making at hundreds of kilometers per second. It's a structure so vast that light itself takes over 100 million years to cross it. You'd be forgiven for thinking this must be the end of the line, that this scale is the largest there is. But the Virgo supercluster, in all its unimaginable grandeur, is just one node in an even more magnificent structure. It's time for our final and most mind-bending zoom out. We've gone from our small rocky home to our star, our galaxy, our local group, and our home supercluster. Now, we take the final leap to the edge of everything we can possibly see. When we look out at the largest scales, we find that superclusters aren't just scattered around randomly. They're organized into a breathtaking structure known as the cosmic web. Immense filaments of galaxies and dark matter stretch for hundreds of millions of light years, connecting in dense nodes where superclusters lie. These filaments surround vast, nearly empty regions called cosmic voids. On the grandest scale, the universe looks something like a sponge or a network of neurons. So, to get our final number, we need to know how many galaxies are in this web. Thanks to deep sky surveys, like the Hubble Ultra Deep Field, astronomers can peer into a tiny, dark patch of the sky, count all the galaxies they see, and then extrapolate that to the entire sky. Early estimates were around 100 to 200 billion galaxies, but deeper analysis, accounting for all the tiny, faint galaxies our telescopes were missing, has pushed that number much higher. The current estimate is that there are as many as in the observable universe. 2 trillion galaxies. Now we have our final building blocks. Let's run the final calculation. We have 2 trillion galaxies. Of course, they vary wildly in size, but let's use a conservative average of 100 billion stars per galaxy. 2 trillion galaxies, each with 100 billion suns, gives you 200 sextillion stars. And since we're confident there's at least one planet per star, that's 200 sextillion planets. 200,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000, estimated number of planets in the observable universe? 200 sextillion. The number is so big, it's basically an abstract concept. How do we even begin to get our heads around a number like that? Let's go back to the sand. Scientists estimate that there are roughly 7.5 sextillion grains of sand on all the beaches, in all the deserts, on the entire planet Earth. Let that sink in. The number of planets we just calculated, 200 sextillion, is more than the number of grains of sand on our whole world. Think about that. Stand on a beach and pick up a single grain of sand. That's a planet. Now look at the whole beach. That's not the universe. Not even close. You would have to imagine every desert, every coastline, every sandbox on Earth, 25 times over, just to have a pile of sand grains that equals the number of planets out there. Each grain, a world. A world with its own geography, chemistry, and history. Worlds of swirling gas, worlds of solid diamond, worlds of frozen methane, and worlds with deep, dark oceans. And among them, potentially billions of billions of rocky worlds in just the right place for water and life. This number is the result of a remarkable human journey of curiosity, built on centuries of science and discovery. It started with recognizing planets as worlds, then finding them around other stars, then mapping our galaxy, and finally, mapping the universe itself. But it's also a deeply humbling number. It tells us that our world, our solar system, our entire galaxy, is a rounding error in the grand cosmic census. This journey from 8 planets to 200 sextillion is a reminder of how much we've learned and how much is still out there to discover. We are living in a golden age of astronomy, where the biggest questions are finally within our reach. If your mind is reeling from the scale of it all, and you want to keep exploring these profound cosmic questions, make sure you subscribe and hit that notification bell. And for a closer look at the kinds of worlds we're finding, check out our video on the most bizarre exoplanets ever discovered. So, we have our answer. An estimated 200 sextillion planets in the observable universe. But the real takeaway isn't the number itself. It's the perspective it gives us. For all of history, we've looked at the sky and wondered, are we alone? We still don't have the definitive answer. But we now know this. The stage for life is bigger than anyone could have ever imagined. Billions of potentially habitable worlds in our galaxy alone. Trillions of galaxies, each one seeded with the same raw materials and the same laws of physics. To think that out of 200 sextillion chances, our tiny, fragile world is the only one to have ever harbored life seems, to many, like an extraordinary claim. The universe has rolled the dice sextillions of times. It feels almost inevitable that some of those other worlds are not just habitable, but inhabited. That somewhere out there, on a world orbiting a distant star in a galaxy we will never see, something is looking up at its own sky and asking the exact same question. Our place in the cosmos is this. We are a single note in an unimaginably vast and complex symphony. We may never hear the other notes. But for the first time, we know with scientific certainty that they are almost certainly playing.